believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his death is death's defeat.
Here we go.
Oh, praise to God the Father. Oh, praise to Christ the Son. Oh, praise to the Holy Spirit.
Save my life.
Jesus' mighty name, I believe. Father, you are so faithful. You are a good God. Nothing catches you by surprise. Nothing is outside of your realm of possibility. So, Father, we praise into you this morning. We praise into you this morning. Yes, Jesus. The next song is a new one. It's also in the theme of Believe for It. It's called Believe for It.
Power in your name. Say Thank you. say over the nations. You have the final say of our marriages. You have the final say of our challenges. You have the final say over our obstacles, over our lives. Lord, you have the final say. You're in charge of the whistle, Lord. And until you blow that whistle, it's not over yet. There's still hope. There's still life. You have the final say, Lord. There's so many of us that need to hear that today, that he has the final say. Just when you think it's impossible, he makes it possible. He really does. We thank you, Lord. We say thank you, worship team. Come on. I mag maar sit. You may be seated. It's direct translation. Welcome. If you're joining us for the first time today, would you mind just putting up your hand and wave so we can see you? Martha, welcome. There's some hands down there. We want to just give you a little connect card. Just fill in your details and just want to reach out to you and just pray for you in the week if that's okay with you. I promise I won't spam you and send you all marketing related stuff like, if you buy now, we'll send you this free love gift. I can do the voice, can't I? Yeah. But that's not autumn. You know, for an extra $5. We're a community of followers of Christ. Not only do we want to speak the words of Jesus, we want to do the works of Jesus as well. And we just want to proclaim his name and his fame wherever we go and extend his kingdom. That's who we are. So if you're joining us for the first time, welcome. For all the rest of you, it's good to see you. It feels like I haven't been here for weeks. You're looking all beautiful and lovely and all glistening and glowing. At the Father's house, we love breakfast. Praise the Lord. Oh, that anointing of bacon. And we love birthdays as well. So if it's your birthday this week, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he lavish his love upon you. And we just pray that it'll be like the start of the best years of your life. So on the 23rd, we have Beatrice Mwamba. On the 24th, we have Leonard Joannes, Dawn Fortein, Elijah Mendes, and David Walbrough. On the 25th, Roseanne. Hey, Kega. Kega. We have a brother, Andrew. Andrew Semple. Kega. And Angus Cornelius Gurley Tendai. And on the 26th, we have Dalida Mendes. That's a lot of activity in the Mendes house this week. On the 27th, Bjorn. Oh, my word. Artnik, Natasha Nurkia, Butle Duna. On the 28th, we have Mike van Niekerk and Desiree Arnold. So if you know these folks, reach out to them. Take them a cupcake. Love them. Slobber all over them. You know, just... No halsies. With love. No. Okay, sorry. Our hospital ministry at Carl Bremer this Thursday, coming on the 26th of October. If you want to hang out with them, call contact 80, call the office. They'll put you in touch with the guys that do hospital ministry. They're really having fun out there, praying for sick people. I'm yet to get a report of them raising the dead, but I'm sure that'll happen soon. So just reach out to those guys. Parenting workshop on Sunday the 29th of October, this coming Sunday, at 11:30. That's straight after the service. They'll run for about an hour. And they'll talk on a little topic called how to talk to your kids about sex in a sex-crazed world. Childcare, fill in a Google form. There will be childcare available next door. And just email that to the office or just contact the office on Monday. Connect nights every Wednesday here at the church. It's been going absolutely swimmingly. We've been having a good time just connecting, fellowshipping. So if you want to just come out and connect with us, we have a time of worship. There's a little preach. And we go in groups and, talk about it. People pray for one another. It really has been absolutely fantastic. It's been a joy. Speak to me afterwards if you want to hang out. We have entered into the 22nd century as a church because we have an app. I can't believe it. Even I have the app. And you know how I don't particularly like technology, but even I have engaged in this app. So we have a Father's House Connect app. I encourage you to download the app. Speak to Marlon. Marlon, give us a wave. Ah, you got to actually, no. I was going to be naughty. No, Marlon, I'm not going to take you out today. But there's a QR code at the back if you want to scan it or just speak to Marlon. He'll hook you up. Get onto the app. It's a wonderful way to connect, see what we're up to, see what we're doing all week, see upcoming events, see what's going on. And just, that's great. That's a great app. I love that app. It's very easy to navigate. For those of you who think it's like very difficult, that's very easy. Our regular meetings, youth every Friday, 7 o'clock here at the church, come a little bit early. They normally have coffee, hang out, and they just, you know, hang around. They just do what young people do. Ladies meeting every Wednesday morning here at the church at 9:30. Speak to Veronica. Is that you? Okay, girl. They come together, they pray, they eat. I'm never invited. I'm just saying, eating. I'm just teasing. Healing streams. Make an appointment with these guys. They'll pray for you. They'll minister to you. They'll love on you. Get rid of some chochas if you know. That's just, you'll go there feeling all, yeah, loved and delivered and sanctified and justified. And I nearly said anesthetized, but that does not, that kind of streams. Moms Connect every last Saturday of the month from 2:30. Here at the church, please contact the office for details. Just moms coming together. And what are we doing? It's at Shabbat's house. It is at the feeder's house. Do you know about this? Okay, probably don't. You're not invited. No, you don't seem like the mom kind. We have counseling, marriage counseling. Speak to Jose or Cheryl. Give us a wave so they can see Gaga. Make an appointment with them or contact the office if you need some counseling. TLC, you just wanted somebody just to listen to you. Great stuff. Next week, Sunday, our service is here as normal. It's a family worship service. Everybody comes together. Shine comes in here. We have a good time. We just lift the roof and have, and obviously communion. Who doesn't like a spot of communion? Oh, they're very quiet. Do you know what communion is? You know when Jesus died, right? I was going to get, I'm being naughty. Preach it. Okay, go. Corporate prayer every Sunday morning here at 8:30. It really is just a wonderful time. We just pray together just before the service starts. And that's about the long and the short of that. We have some matriculants in the house. Yes. So we'd like to pray. We'd like to pray for them. If you're in matric or you know somebody that's in matric, this is a good time to stand in the gap for them. But the matriculants we know of in our context, Zenaid Hendricks, Victoria Gomez, Joshua Baptista, and Kyla Fisher. Can we just pray for them for a moment? So, Father, we just pray that your peace that surpasses all understanding will be the plumb line of their hearts and minds as they write exams, as they need to just put down that information on paper, Lord, that you would be with them. Lord, that you would hold them, that you would strengthen them, and that this is a time, Lord, that they would know your presence and that you go before them. Lord, that they wouldn't be anxious for anything, even that they wouldn't even be anxious for the future, and they're wondering what to do next year and all of that stuff, Lord, that you would just give them peace. And we thank you in Jesus' name, that we'll have a good result and good reports from them. In Jesus' name, amen. We also have some family members that are traveling. We have Lucinda Parsons going off to Singapore and Malaysia, Singapore, the East. She's flying very far away. Let's put it that way. And we also have Donna Gablo is also doing some commute between here and Johannesburg. So we also just want to pray for them. You know, Father, we just pray that your travel mercies will go with them, that you would light their path as they go. Father, that you would prosper them in any way, in every way, that they would be a blessing to others wherever they go. Father, that you, Lord, would just come and just wherever they set their feet on, Lord, that they would be known as your children, that people would see your glory through them, and that your love would flow. And Father, as they travel and they come back to this house, that you would bring them home safely every time. Just think of their families as well, that you would just strengthen them while they're away and they're traveling, that you would provide in all their needs, in Jesus' name. Amen. Tithes and offerings. Raphael, you've been sitting there for a long time. It almost feels like you haven't done anything much. You haven't spoken today. Would you pray for the tithe and offering?
Is that enough to say? Yeah, Father, we just thank you for these offerings, Lord, these tithes. And Lord, we pray that you bless every hand that is given, Lord. Bless families in this house, Lord. And Father, bring increase to every household represented here today. For those not here, Lord, and those not able to give, that you provide, Lord. And Father, that those that are the ones that need to spend, that you give them wisdom, Lord, and that they'll use these wisely for your kingdom. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Raphael. And now, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, and those watching all over the world, now, Timothy.
Good morning, everybody. Goeiemôre. Are you doing well? You good? Oh, Martha, we're going to pray for you after the service. Okay. I'm sure you guys are still recovering from last night. So I'm going to be gracious this morning. Okay. But I do want to say, I see the mullahs are sitting there. Yes. Okay. Next week. Dudley, I'm just saying, if the church is empty next week, then I'm coming to visit all of you. And I'll put my All Blacks now on. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. And it's good to worship the Lord. So this morning, I just felt like there was such a faith in the house because God is in the house. And let us pray, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for a new day. Father, I thank you that every person who's here today is here because, not by chance, Father, but because you have purpose for us to be here. And I thank you, Father, for your word, and I thank you that your word always goes out to fulfill that which it has been purposeful in our lives. And so, Father, we open up our hearts. We pray, Father, that you may speak to us, that you may encourage us, that you may challenge us, that, Lord, that you may lift us up, that we may be able to see from heaven's perspective in all things, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I prepared a word yesterday before the game. Okay. And I got this word, and I'm going to just share it with you. The God of new things. This week, I don't know about you, but I enjoyed the sunny weather. And I know, my wife and I have been talking about, like, when is winter going to come to an end, you know? It's almost like the season of winter was hanging on as long as it could, you know? And then it's amazing how you start to reminisce and you wonder, man, do you remember last summer, spring, how it was? And you know, and you start to build this expectation for the next season. And then when it comes, like now, we've had a few days, and when it comes, and eventually, after a couple of days, maybe a week or two, you start moaning how hot it is in this church. I said to the guys, in fact, the bassist, recent PW, I'm going to wear my shorts next week and my T-shirt. If you want to pray for me, come to me afterwards. Okay. But seasons come and seasons go. And in our lives, it's exactly the same. You know, you go through a season and you're asking the Lord, when is it going to come to an end? When? And it's like you're waiting and waiting, and then all of a sudden it happens. And I know, like this morning, you know, I felt it, like there's a breakthrough in our spirits. But to hold on to the new. You know, it's easy to forget when the season's there, you know, and eventually everything is cool and everything, and then all of a sudden we become accustomed to it. And then we start to reminisce about the next season, you know. I've got friends that used to come every year from the States to come and see us. And they said to me, Tim, we're never going to travel to you guys during June, July. You know, because they did it once and they said it was the worst weather they've ever seen. So they planned their trips. And they were coming for like 10 years, you know, every year just to come and do ministry here and come and see us. But they planned their trips after that winter. The worst winter they've ever experienced. They made sure that they came either, you know, spring, like September, October. In fact, I think this September wasn't going to work. And or like at March, April, you know that. And so every year I would expect them during that season or those seasons. Sometimes the seasons we are in can be really long. It can feel long. And sometimes we can become almost despondent because we're expecting the new season to come very quickly. This morning, I want to share a word with you about Naomi and Ruth. And all the ladies go, amen. Because it's normally a woman's day, eh? A woman's day message. But I want to speak to you about Naomi particularly and how she handled a new season by letting go of an old. But look at the scripture with me, Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1 to 8. I'm going to read the whole thing because when I was pondering on this and yesterday I thought, wow, there's so much happening in the world, but look what Ecclesiastes says. There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under the sun. So we can rest assured. What the Bible is saying, there will be seasons and things will come and things will go. Things will happen. Things will come to an end. It says a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. Lucinda. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. And you may be wondering, how can the Bible say hate? You know, the Bible says you've got to hate sin. There are things that you can hate, not people. A time for war and a time for peace. It's amazing that every day, look outside, every single day is a reset from the previous day. I don't know if you realize that. In fact, when you sleep, your body resets itself. Your cells regenerate. There's more healing that happens while you're sleeping. By the time you wake up, you've actually recovered, reset. And last night was very late, and so some of you are still recovering and resetting. I get it, okay? I'm one of them. But God's design is to reset you. Isn't that just amazing? That God would lead you into restoration all the time. He'll reset you. It means that there will always be a new beginning in the kingdom of God. You go to sleep and you worry and, you know, you wake up in the morning and you leave that worry. I don't know if you ever experienced that. It's the design of the Father. So like the birds, I mean, we've got a lot of bird life there by us. I hear them from 4 o'clock already. But about 10 o'clock or so, I don't know, maybe a little earlier, it's quiet. And then they wake up about 4, you know, and they wide awake. And it's almost like there's an expectation for the new day. God wants us to have an expectation for life. He wants us to have an expectation for a reset. This world needs a reset. And you know, a lot of people have been talking about, oh, this is going to happen, that's going to happen. Let me tell you, there's a time for war, then there's a time for peace. God will always intervene to reset and restore that which he has created. So the main story today is about Naomi. And it's amazing, you know, that Naomi, is Naomi. Hello. Do you know what your name means? You do. Your name means pleasant and gentle. So if you know Naomi, guys, you'll see that, right? So Naomi means pleasant and gentle. That was the identity, God's design for this lady, for you two, for this woman, Naomi. But Naomi went through a really, really rough season. She lost her husband, and she lost her two sons. Now, I know some of you are sitting here, and you've lost your husbands. Some have lost their wives. Some of us have lost loved ones, particularly in the last season, a couple of years. So just imagine, you lose your husband, and you lose your only two sons. Naomi's loss was something that affected her so much that she even renamed herself. And you know what she called herself? She called herself Mara. Mara means bitter. Sometimes the season in life, if you're not careful, can lead you to bitterness, losses, if we're not dealing with it. That's why we have healing streams. That's why we have counselors. God's gifted people to help us to be able to work through a season of loss. Because if you don't work through it, then you can become bitter. And before you know it, bitterness becomes your identity. And everything you look at life through the lens of bitterness, everything you see is seen through that lens. And before you know it, life is just bad. Everything is bad. So what happened to Naomi is that she had two daughter-in-laws. Ruth was one of them. In fact, Naomi said to her, you can go back to your father, remarry. Go live your life. Go enjoy your life. Start afresh. It's amazing that Naomi would say that to her, but she herself was struggling to start afresh. And the Lord challenged me with this. Are we willing to allow the Lord to start us afresh? Maybe you're running a business. I had this for a couple of months, asking the Lord, I was sharing this with Andrew yesterday, asking the Lord, man, you know, I run a studio as well, by the way. I'm not just a pastor, okay? We are tent makers. Diddy's working. Marlon also has his own business. In fact, most of the staff is actually by vocation. And since COVID, you know, people don't prioritize recording music as a necessity, you know? I mean, I always knew that. And so since COVID, I've been praying this prayer, asking, Father, how do we restart this? And you know, you submit your business to the Lord. And you say, Father, because you started it, you gave it favor, I can't do this. You're gonna have to give me, the Bible says, he gives you the ability to create wealth. In other words, there's work that we do to create that wealth. And so I said, Lord, restart this thing. And it's been quiet, man, for a long time, you know? It's like, Lord, you're still there. Remember when we started the studio, what you said, you know? Remember 10 years of working to get the vision to build the studio. I said, and then we did it. Remember that? Remember? Come on, Lord, give me the answer, right? Give me the new restart. What is the restart? You know, you sit and you want to be smart, you know. You start looking at the market. You start working out a plan. You know, maybe if I do it this way. And then God just kind of like stops that. Frank Sinatra said, I did it my way. I know. You know, and then a couple of weeks ago, Actually, I can't remember where I was, but I got a phone call, and this person asked me, hey, I know you built the studio. Not that I physically built it, but I designed it. I did design it, you know. Took many years to research and find all the best way to build a studio and most effective and cost-effective. So this person phones me and says, you know, we need some soundproofing. And my head is like this, right? That's not my business. I'm not a contractor, man. George, I'm getting this call, and I'm thinking, you know what? I can advise you. I can send you to the right people. I know exactly what to do, where to do. And the person says to me, yeah, but why didn't you just do it? Like, why didn't you just run this thing? And I said, so I stopped, and I thought, okay, I'll get back to you. I went and I spoke to my wife, and she's looking also at me confused, like, are you sure? This has got nothing to do with music, you know? And then I sat down, and I heard that voice that said to me, start a studio, record some music, produce music. I heard that voice, and then I realized I prayed a prayer, and the Lord answered it. So easy how you can miss it. Because sometimes the answer comes, but it's not the way that you wanted. And it's right there. It's like, okay, I'm going to reset you. I'm going to restart you. And I'm going to put it right in front of you. Because now, here's the key. What are you going to do? Yeah. Just like the Lord is playing chess, you know. I've made my move. What is your move, Tim? And I tell you, then doubt came, you know. Can I do this? Man, it's a responsibility. It's funny because I carry lots of responsibilities, but you know, when you face something unknown, then fear somehow just comes and doubt comes, and then it kind of wants to form your identity, and it tells you, no, you can't do this. No, you know. And I had to stop myself, and eventually I made my mind up. I did all the, I did the cost, you know, the costing. I called the guys that built my studio, and I said, hey, are you guys keen? Are you ready? And they like, we are ready. You know, everybody's looking for work, eh? And so I go through, and I looked at the place, and I sent them the quote, and they accepted it. Now, you know, firstly, the fear of stepping into the unknown. Secondly, the fear of rejection. I don't know. Eh? The fear that they might just come back and say, no. Too expensive, or not anything, like it's just kind of low. We're going to go with somebody who knows, done this before. So I meet the guy, the owner of the business, or one of the owners, Andrew, and he says to me, so you run a studio? I said, yeah. He says, and you make music? I said, yeah. He says, and now you're doing soundproofing? And I said, yeah. Yeah. And I tell you, amazing, he's a Christian, he leads worship, and we start talking about the Lord, you know, and he's like, man, it's so good to hear somebody that's got faith, you know, and we start encouraging one another. New seasons are scary. But I tell you something. What it does, and I'm gonna show you with Naomi's life, it brings and births forth something far greater than the previous season. If you are willing to let God birth it. And some of you are stepping out of your comfort zone, traveling to other nations, going, and the voices are speaking, you know. Voices are coming and saying, can you do this? Who do you think you are? Are you good enough? So, Naomi turns to Ruth and says, Ruth, I want you to go back to your father and go and remarry. And Ruth says to her, and I'm going to read the scripture because it's so profound. This is so important, who you surround yourself with. Who's around you when you step into the new? What voices are speaking into your life? Ruth says to Naomi, don't urge me to leave you or turn back from you. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, sure, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me. Who you surround yourself with will determine who you become and where you're heading. And I ask myself the question, you know, because it's easy to say, okay, so who are my friends? Who are the ones that are with me? Who are the ones that are with you? But I turn that question, what kind of friend am I? Hey, when you put the mirror in front of you, it's easy to say, yeah, but I had friends. And man, look at my back. Turn that mirror. What kind of friend am I? Am I faithful to others? Am I committed to others? And I tell you, faithfulness is easy when things are good, eh? It's very easy. We love each other, we're buddies, man. But when we disagree, when there's something that comes and it's like, then your faithfulness is tested, eh? You know what I found is that when you go through that, and you go through it, not avoid it, don't, you know, hide, and you go through it, whatever friend, maybe it's even your spouse, right? When you go, you come out stronger. You come out way more together in your relationship. Who is surrounding you? And who are you surrounding? I'm so I don't know if it's a generation today, Marlon, but I'm really blessed to see how the young people are supporting one another. They are counseling each other, man. I mean, we you know, our daughters, they send messages off the phone. They don't have their own phones. It's a choice we made, but, you know, they send messages, and we can see that's part of what our deal is, you know. We have access to the messages. To see how they are counseling each other in the Lord. I'm like, Lynette's not here this weekend. She's ministering in Nelspruit, eh? But I'm like, man, well done, Lynette and that whole Shine team. Well done, Marlon, and your leadership. These guys have learned how to encourage one another in the Lord. So we read, and look, it's about a boy, and it's about a girl, and, you know, I get that. We were all there. You were there. But you know what, eh? The maturity in Jesus. I was like, man. Because we're worried, eh? We were looking at the, and we're like, hopefully we don't see something we don't want to see. You know, read something you don't want to read, you know? No. It's like, come on. Jesus has got you. Last week I heard, I think Jason? Yeah, I think it was your nephew. But they did this, God words, and, eh? God time, that's it. And so this little boy, you know, they're sitting and they're drawing, and he draws, okay, so bear with me, Minecraft is a game, okay? If you don't know about it, talk to some young people. He draws this Minecraft game, and then he draws a picture of Jesus, and he gets up. How old is your nephew, man? He's 7 years old. He gets up and he says, "You can play Minecraft, huh? But you must subscribe to Jesus." 7 years old. And listen, to the point that my daughter, you know, she's a teenager, she's serving there. She was so excited. She came home. She said, "Dad, you gotta hear this. So I heard that story about 3 times now, Marcel. But you know what is encouraging is that is who they're surrounding themselves with. Who's speaking? Which voices are the loudest in your heart. So we all need people like Ruth in our lives. And we all need to be a Ruth to others. Can't do that with everybody. But find one, find two. Outside of your family. I mean, this is the other amazing thing. You know, society says in-laws will never get along. I heard that all the time. I hear it still, you know. It's almost like it's engraved in us that in-laws will never get along. What happens here is Ruth displays the gospel of Jesus that breaks the norm of society to bring a togetherness, a unity, where others would see division or expect division. And I believe that is a word for the world today. Don't let society determine who you're with. Don't allow, that's not the gospel of Jesus. In fact, Ephesians 2 says that he broke the dividing walls. And I'm saying S at the end of all. Because Paul was writing specifically about Jews and Gentiles. But today, it would be Israelis and Palestinians. Today it will be Russians and Ukrainians. Jesus broke the dividing wall. That's why we pray. We pray that everyone may come to know him so that they can become one. Which voices are you listening to? And who are you surrounding yourself with? The second thing that happens with Naomi is that she went home with Ruth. She went to her homeland, and she had to face the reality of her bitterness. You know, people welcomed her, in fact, and back home, her friends, her family, and then they called her Naomi, and she said, no, call me Mara. She had to face the reality of what was happening inside of you. Sometimes we suppress things so deep, you know, and we leave it there and we think that we're okay by not facing the realities of the things that we've been through. In this church, it's about authenticity. And I shared this, I think, last week and a week before. You know, it doesn't matter how you dress, you'll see on the stage, you know. The basis is, St. Peter is, I like your toes, man. St. Peter is there, you know. We're not worried about how you look. Because God sees the heart, right? So we don't have to pretend. Naomi faced it. Call me Mara. Sometimes we hide those things and we put on the happy face. The pleasant face. I've even seen myself sometimes do what they call a passive-aggressive thing. You know, you come across gentle, but actually deep inside, you're fighting. It's like the duck, you know? He looks all calm on top, but the bottom. Going nowhere slowly. You have to face it. You have to acknowledge it, because when you acknowledge it, then God can work. Then the Lord steps in again. Here's my move, Tim. Watch your move. Here's my move, Lord. Yes, now I can move. We got to deal with the bitterness. We got to deal with the resent. Thank you. I preach with you. And we got to allow God to call out our true identity. So what does God say to Naomi? He looks at her and he says, you know what? It's okay. That's where you're at. And then he says, now I'm going to show you a new beginning. What happens is Ruth gets married to Boaz. There's a lot in there. You can go read it. It's an amazing story. The book is called the book of Ruth. Okay. Ruth gets married to Boaz, and they have a son. And the women of the village are so excited. They are rejoicing, and Naomi's standing there, and they are rejoicing. And you know what? The Bible says they named the son, the women in the village. Not even the family. Bible says it's the neighbors. And you know what they named the son? They named the son Obed. Obed means servant of God, worshiper. Obed was the grandfather of King David, the worshiper, the warrior. Obed was the seed that came out of bitterness, that became, I mean, you want to go all the way, became the lineage of Jesus, who stood and died for you and me to bring all together to eradicate bitterness once and for all. God, when He changes things, He doesn't only change it in you. He changes it for your whole, the generations coming all after you, for your whole lineage, for your whole family, for your whole life. And I tell you, I've sat with people that said to me, yeah, but if you just know what I went through, man, come on. Do you think my God is that small? If you just know how I grew up. I could have been there. I tell you, I could have been there. I had a gun right here. And as a teenager, sitting in the street in Bridgetown, drunk men came up, two of them, put a gun and pulled the trigger. You know, I was so angry, you know, because, man, I was young. Things happen, but you have a choice. Things happen, but you have the choice. You can let it go. And you can say, God, I surrender to you. I said to myself, I will not allow my circumstances to shape me. And I thank the Lord. Because I prayed, you know, then already. I prayed that my children will not get to experience a life like that. And I tell you, it wasn't easy. Because I had a lot of doubt, I had a lot of fear, a lot of insecurities. I couldn't look at white people in the eye, Veronica. I had a friend who you surround yourself with. He took me out to Spur. Spur was a big deal. Okay. He took me out to Spur, sat me down. He was my worship leader. And he said, Tim, look at me in the eye. You know why I couldn't look? Because I felt inferior. I felt I wasn't worth. He said, Tim, look at me in the eye. And he said, I'm going to teach you who you really are. And that guy walked with me for years. Shavay met him. He came to my wedding. I mean, he was just an amazing, he was like a big brother to me. And he helped me. He, you know, he was the first person to say on the phone, I love you. And I thought, dude, we don't do that like in the hood, you know what I mean? You don't go around saying, I love you, bro. And he used to do that intentionally, you know, and I went quiet, like my tongue just like numbed. I couldn't answer him. And then eventually, you know, after a few calls, I love you too, man. you start with ditto. That's what you start with, ditto. Ditto. Yeah, some of you guys don't know what ditto is. And then you eventually, you just like, love you too. Bam, fun down. Who you are, who the Lord says you are. Are you willing to let go of the old? Are you willing to let go of the false? So I wrote this down, and we are going to end a little earlier today, but we do want to do some ministry. I'm going to ask Jason, also the worship casters, to get ready for that. Let me read this, Ruth 4:14-17. This is where the ladies are excited. And they said, blessed be the Lord, who has not left you this day without a close relative. And may his name be famous in Israel, and may he be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age, Pete. I heard Pete. There you are. Love you, man. A nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law who loves you, who is better to you than and seven sons. I don't know what that means. Seven sons has borne him. The baby, right? Then Naomi took the child. Now look at this. Laid him on her bosom and became a nurse to him. Also the neighbor women gave him the name, saying, there's a son born to Naomi, not to Ruth. Hey, to Naomi. Do you know what they were talking about? The restoration of Naomi. She lost a husband, the seed. She lost the sons. Childless, God gave her through Ruth. Gospel of Jesus, all in the story, right? There's a son born to Naomi, and they called his name Obed. He is the father of Jesse, the father of David. And so this is what God does. He takes bitterness from bitterness, and he gives you blessing. He takes hopelessness, and he gives you restoration. He takes loneliness, and he gives you community. He takes childless barrenness, and he gives you fruit. Fruitfulness. And he takes false identity, and he gives you God's identity. This morning, I believe that the Lord wants us to step into a new season. For some, we've got to let go of the old. We've got to let go. Disappointments, things that didn't happen the way we thought. And we're going to have to this morning make a choice and say, Lord, I surrender to you and I allow you to lead me and guide me, restore me. I love the fact that Naomi became a nurturer. Out of bitterness, she became the nurture, the one to nurse the baby. You got to nurse what God births in you, Roseanne. You got to protect it. You got to hold it. You got to, feed it, You know what I mean. I believe that's the word for you. Got to nurse it. Don't allow the words of negativity, Royston. He's birthed it already. When you go get that award, you don't have to worry about everybody else back home, eh? He's birthed it already. You've got to nurse it, protect it, submit it to the Lord and say, God, you gave this. Let your will be done. So, Jason, I'm going to ask you, and I'm going to ask our leaders to help, Derek and Veronica. Steph, you can help me this morning. But I want to pray for you. And we're gonna open up. We'll open the space, but even where you are, if you don't have to come to the front, you're just going to need to indicate to us so we can come to you, we pray for you. But I believe that some of you got to allow the Lord to break it off. Yep. Just let it go. Let it go. It's too heavy to carry anyway. Hey, it's too heavy. Let it go. Let him come and let him guide you into that newness, restoration, new season. And we're going to let the Lord do that this morning. And are you ready? So close your eyes with me, just out of respect for those around you as well. But this morning, if you're sitting here and you've heard, and you might be thinking, Tim, you kind of read. You just like read my mail here. This is where I'm at. I'm going to ask you to stand this morning because we want to pray for you, but I also believe that when you stand, you're actually making a decision, showing and displaying a decision before the Lord that I'm willing to step into the new thing you have for me, God. So as I was praying last night, and I missed the first half of the game Well, I think 20 minutes or 30 minutes or something. The Lord said to me, the losses, the season of loss for some might have been people, but for others, it's not people. It might be a loss of maybe, you know, a vision you had, a dream you had, and somehow it was taken away. It was, for others, it's, I feel like in business, some of you have experienced the losses around you. For others, it's maybe, you know, you had a job, you had a work, but you don't have the work anymore. And so whatever that loss is, you submit that to the Lord this morning. That we don't allow the negativities and the disappointments to get root in us to cause any kind of bitterness to spring forth. So, wherever you are, you want some prayer ministry, I ask you to stand. You are good and you are good, Lord. Restoration, God. In you a new day dawns. So before we come and we pray for you, just, you know, you open your hands like you're receiving a gift. Just bring your heart before the Lord as the worship, the band just begins to play some music of worship unto the Lord. Allow the Lord to wash over you. His love, His joy, His peace, His restoration.
Encourage everyone, if you If you want to stay behind, we invite you to stay behind. If you just want to sit, we invite you to sit. But we're going to close here for those who would like to leave. And we're just going to worship for those who'd like to stay. Feel free. So bless you. We love you. And we'll see you next week. So just